Hello everyone. In the previously uploaded video, we talked about the inherited torsional moment, which is caused by the eccentricity between the location of center of mass and center of rigidity. Also, I have previously shown in detail how the modeling techniques used may impact the calculations of the diaphragm's center of mass and center of rigidity. And we have agreed that we need to use this model in our study because it is the model that provides the most accurate results. And going to the new ETABS model, I have divided those elements into smaller pieces. And to create this division, you need to create this grid system named G3. And let's check this grid system by right-clicking on the screen. And you can just copy those grid coordinates as shown here and here to create this division, okay? Going back to our Excel sheets, let's check the changes resulting from the transition to the new model. As shown here, we are using the design response spectrum that correspond to the 5% damping ratio inside the ETABS. Therefore, nothing has changed. For the building weight, of course, we need to use those accurate masses, and at the end, we should get the same values of masses for stories and diaphragms. Also, there are changes regarding the results of the model participating mass ratios. In the new model, the new element division leads to a new stiffness matrix that is different from the one used in the previous model. Therefore, due to this difference in the stiffness matrix, we will get different results in terms of those model properties. However, we should get very close results to the previous ones, okay? Moving on to the equivalent lateral force procedure, nothing has changed, and we got the same base shear, which is around 2190 kN. And regarding the wind loads calculation, nothing has changed. We need to import these loads into ETABS software as we have done before. And regarding the stiffness, I'm using the 0.7 IG for the walls as the flexural stiffness, and we need to use all of those values here for the stiffnesses of the members, okay? And of course, I have explained previously how to do this. Regarding the computation of the tensile stresses of walls and comparing them to the modulus of rupture, nothing has changed, and we should use the uncracked section for the walls. Of course, I have checked the tensile stresses of core number 1 and 2 in the new ETABS model with the rupture modulus, and to confirm that, I have included this figure here for illustration. Here we have those small yellow dots while here nothing appears, okay? Therefore, the tensile stresses of walls don't exceed the modulus of rupture. Also, I want to note that I'm only including this example to provide additional clarity to the idea. Therefore, don't mix between those two examples. Lastly, in our last uploaded video, we computed the eccentricity caused by the center of mass and center of rigidity, termed as the inherited torsion. And as I have mentioned before, this effect is already accounted for within the ETABS software. And now we need to compute the accidental torsion, and we need to explain it in detail. And before that, going to ASCE 710, we should read this paragraph here regarding the accidental torsion. Where diaphragms are not flexible, the design shall include the inherent torsional moment MT resulting from the location of the structure masses plus the accidental torsional moments MTA caused by the assumed displacement of the center of mass each way from its actual location by 5% of the building's dimensions. Therefore, we are just taking into consideration the uncertainties surrounding the precise location of the center of mass. And let me clarify more. When designing a building with tools like ETABS, we assume a uniform distribution of weights across the floors. However, factors like the people's movement, furniture placement, and other factors make this distribution unpredictable. Therefore, what we should know is that our assumptions regarding the load distribution in the computer program might not perfectly match what happens in real life, and that's why we need to consider the accidental torsional effects in our structural analysis, okay? Also, we need to amplify the accidental torsional moment for structures assigned to those seismic design categories and when one type of the torsional irregularities exist, using the torsional amplification factor AX or using this equation. Then don't worry about this, I will explain it in detail using this Excel sheet. And zooming into the first case, let's start checking the accidental torsional effects using the static forces from the equivalent lateral force procedure. And to include this effect within ETABS software, we need to go to the defined load patterns of the ELF method. And we need to make sure that we have included here the 5% eccentricity and we have checked those boxes here. And similarly, for the lateral loads applied in the y direction, we need to check those boxes here and we need to include the 5% eccentricity in this box, okay? Therefore, we can now proceed to check the accidental torsional effect within ETABS using the static method known as ELF procedure, okay? And to achieve this, we need to obtain the floor displacements of the corner joints as shown here in this figure in the direction of the applied loads. Therefore, if we are applying the loads in the x direction, we need to use this side here, which is perpendicular to the applied forces, and we need to obtain the displacements of those corner joints. And similarly, for applying the loads in the y direction, we need to use this side, which is perpendicular to the applied loads, and we need to obtain the corner displacements in the direction of the applied loads for this joint and this one here, okay? And of course, we need to obtain the displacements to compute the AX factor shown in ASCE 710. And please keep in mind that this factor shouldn't exceed 3 and shouldn't be less than 1. Then there is no need to amplify the torsional moment inside our structural model if the AX factor doesn't exceed 1, okay? And let me remind you that this building is symmetrical along the x-axis but not along the y-axis. And this implies that applying lateral loads at the center of mass along the x-axis will result in rotation in this building. However, applying lateral loads directly at the CM in the y direction will result in a translational response only without any rotation, okay? However, when examining the accidental torsional effect, it is important to apply lateral loads at the shifted center of mass. And let me clarify more by zooming into the first case here. For applying the lateral loads in the x direction, we need to create two cases. And we need first to shift the center of mass in the negative y direction, and for the second case, we need to shift it by 5% in the positive y direction, okay? Similarly, for applying lateral loads in the y direction, we need to create two cases. We need to shift the center of mass by 5% in the negative x direction once, and we need to do the same in the positive x direction. Therefore, there are a total of 4 cases from this analysis. However, I have included 2 extra cases as shown here in those 2 tables by considering the results when applying lateral loads at the center of mass. And I'm including those 2 cases to highlight that the building may experience rotation even without considering the 5% eccentricity, okay? And now to obtain the displacements for the selected joints, let's go to ETABS and set the plan view to story number 8 and let's choose the all the stories option. Zooming in to this side, we need to select those 2 joints here and here. And noting the bottom left corner, 16 joints selected, which means we select the same 2 joints in the lower floors. And now we need to export the displacement results of the selected joints by going to the display show tables and checking the joint displacement option and choosing the ELF procedure applied in the X direction. And let's export this table to Excel. And as shown in this table, we have 2 joint labels. So let's select the first one, which is labeled as 69. And let's go back to ETABS software to check which joint is labeled as 69 by right-clicking at one of those 2 joints. And as shown here, we are now obtaining the displacements of this joint, okay? And now we need to choose the step number 1, which corresponds to the case of applying lateral loads directly at the center of mass. And let's copy the joint displacements in the direction of the applied loads to our Excel sheet. And we just need to do the same for the rest of these steps. And in the same manner, let's copy the displacement results of the second joint to our Excel sheet. And to make the process clearer, I'm showing you how to obtain the displacement results from ETABS software and where we need to paste them. However, everything else in this sheet will be calculated automatically. And as shown here, the AX factor doesn't exceed 1 in all cases, and the ratio of the maximum to the average displacement doesn't exceed 1.2. indicating no torsional irregularity, and referring to the table of ASCE that defines the existence of the torsional irregularities in building structures. And as stated, torsional irregularity exists if the ratio of the maximum to the average displacement exceeds 1.2. And in our case, the ratio doesn't exceed 1.2 on all cases. Therefore, torsional irregularity doesn't exist under the laws of the LF method applied in the X direction. And to obtain the displacements due to the applied loads in the Y direction, we need to repeat the same process in ETABS. We need to select the joints on the other side, and we need to deselect this one here. Also, we should ensure that we choose the LF method applied in the Y direction rather than in the X direction, and we need to obtain the results as we have done before. Although I won't go through it again, and rather let's focus here on the results obtained. And please note that the symmetry in this structure along the x-axis results in a pure translational response when lateral loads are applied directly at the center of mass. And this is confirmed by the ratio of the maximum to the average displacements, which is equal to 1 in this case. Also, we have a special case due to the symmetry applying lateral loads to both cases here to the shifted center of mass yields the same results as shown here and here, okay? Therefore, there is no need to amplify the torsional moment using the LF procedure, okay? And now let's shift our focus to the response spectrum analysis method and explore how it handles the accidental torsional effect. And we have two main techniques to include the accidental torsion within the RSA method. The first technique involves applying the accidental torsion as a static torsional moment, while the second technique deals with adjusting the center of mass location and running multiple response spectrum analysis. And to make the idea clearer, I have defined a load case with diaphragm eccentricity set to 0. This case serves as a baseline to understand the behavior without including the accidental torsional effect. And by displaying the deformed shape in the plan view for our response spectrum analysis defined in both directions, we can observe that the floor displacements in the X direction are different, implying that the structure is rotating due to the inherited torsion, while under lateral loss applied in the Y direction, the floor displacements are the same, and this is because we have symmetry along the X axis and there is essentially no inherited torsion. Moving on to the first technique and setting the diaphragm eccentricity to 5% will result in applying a static torsional moment at the center of mass of each floor. And applying the 5% eccentricity to the spectra applied in the X direction will yield a torsional moment equal to the story forces in that direction multiplied by a 5% of the building dimension in the Y direction. And it is important to note that with a rigid diaphragm, the static torsional moment is applied at the center of mass, while if a semi-rigid diaphragm were used, the static torsions would be applied at each node. And displaying the deformed shape as shown here and here with the 5% eccentricity reveals a significant increase in floor displacements in the Y direction compared to the case with zero eccentricity. Additionally, as shown here, ETABS software applies the static torsional moment to clock and counterclockwise, and this is confirmed by checking the display deformed shape as the corner results are the same here. This means that ETABS provides the envelope results of the two cases. However, this technique doesn't account for the amplification of the accidental torsion since it applies the static torsional moment to the final combined results. Therefore, it is incorrect to compute the AX factor based on the displacements obtained from the response spectrum analysis, as these results here correspond to the peak response and don't represent the actual response occurring now. And let me elaborate more. In RSA, the analysis is conducted to determine the structure's response to dynamic loads at various frequencies. The total combined response obtained from RSA represents the peak displacements and forces experienced by the structure over its entire range of modes. Then each mode contributes differently to the overall structural response, and the total combined response doesn't represent the real behavior that the structure exhibits due to the applied loads. And the total combined response from RSA includes contributions from all modes, therefore it doesn't provide a clear picture of the real response, and this makes it unsuitable for calculating the AX factor. And this is the main difference between the RSA and ELF method. In the ELF method, we obtain displacements that occur simultaneously at the moment due to the applied load. while in the RSA method, we get the maximum response that the structure could experience throughout its life. Then it is wrong to compute the AX factor using the final results of the RSA method. And to determine the AX factor using the RSA method, it is essential to conduct calculations at the model level. This involves computing the AX factor for each mode and, if necessary, considering the torsion amplification at the model level. However, I don't recommend this approach because it may require a great deal of effort, and instead I propose a more effective technique which involves adjusting the location of the center of mass. And it is worth noting that the ASCE code allows for the exclusion of the torsional irregularity check if accidental torsion effects are integrated into the dynamic model. Then users can skip the process of determining torsional irregularity by employing technique 2 as specified in the ASCE code, okay? And to include the effects of the accidental torsion into the dynamic analysis model, the center of mass must be offset from its actual or calculated position, moving it by a distance equal to our code-specified eccentricity in both the plus and minus directions. Then let me explain the process in ETABS using an example of an RSA load case with a shifted center of mass in the positive y direction, and we need first to define a new mass source and shift the center of mass by 5% in the positive y direction. Then we need to create a load case with the type of nonlinear static and include the newly defined mass source in this load case. After that, we need to define a new model load case and select the previously defined nonlinear static case from the drop-down list. And lastly, we need to define a load case with the type of response spectrum and choose the newly defined model load case. And the new mass source will be included in this load case as shown here in this box. Then this results in obtaining a new model property of the building as the eigenvalue problem is solved based on the adjusted location of masses, okay? Also note that a total of 4 response spectrum analyses are needed, 2 in each direction, to comprehensively capture the dynamic behavior of the structure. Then guys, before ending this video, let me summarize all the ideas covered. The accidental torsional effects can be included in the static equivalent lateral force procedure. The AX factor can be computed from the ELF results, and if necessary, torsion amplification can be applied by providing the specified eccentricity to each diaphragm, okay? The results from the response spectrum analysis method cannot be used to compute the AX factor, as they represent the combined response of several modes and not the real structural response. And to include the accidental torsional effect in the RSA method, we have 2 techniques. The first is by providing the 5% eccentricity in the RSA load case, and this will result in applying a static torsional moment at the center of mass clock and counterclockwise. While the second technique deals with adjusting the center of mass location. And in both techniques, it is wrong to compute the AX factor based on the final results of the RSA load case, or to amplify the accidental torsion using these results. And keep in mind that if the second technique is used, there is no need to compute the AX factor, as the accidental torsional effect is already included in the model analysis. Lastly, I want to say I may suggest technique 1 for regular building structures, just to induce some torsion, while I may recommend technique 2 for buildings with torsional irregularities where the torsional response is critical, okay? And this is the end of this tutorial. I hope you find it useful and stay tuned for my next video.